It's okay.
Emotions, to say the least, of a day of sadness, but real celebration. Today we celebrate together all that life has to offer, and specifically in the life of Ike and beloved dad and grandfather and great-grandfather and friend to so many. So today I've brought with me an order of service so that we can do this together and celebrate this journey with one another. So we begin, and by the way, for those of you who don't know, I know all the children, I could be sitting in the very back pew over by the wall, and he would come in just about at the beginning, so, and then leave just before I get back there at the end. So he wouldn't want all this attention and fanfare, but we're gonna do it anyhow. Let's begin with a call to worship. We come, O God, in joy tinged with grief this day. We gather here to celebrate the life of your son, Howard Morris, who now resides in eternal life with you. Harold, excuse me. I have a typo and I apologize for that. We come gathering here this day to celebrate the son, your son, Harold Morris, who now resides in eternal life with you. Be with us, O God. Help us to rejoice and be glad in you. The God who raised Jesus Christ from the dead raises us to new life. Help us to know the one we love is with you in new life.
Thanks be to God. Glory to our God, our Creator, to Jesus, our risen Christ, and to the Spirit, our Comforter. Amen.
We pray together. Heavenly Creator, you have given us many gifts in our lives. For the joy, love, and fullness of our lives, we are grateful. Today, we pause in this time and place to especially thank you for giving us such a treasured gift in Harold Morris. His smile and his wisdom, his love and his faith forever changed our lives and so many others we may not be aware of. We are grateful to you for having given him to us all of these years. We ask, O loving God, for your comforting presence to be here with us as we celebrate the gift you so graciously gave to us. Help us to remember that as we say goodbye, you have already said hello. And help us in this time to celebrate and remember the glory of your love and your gift of eternal life. Amen. We have a special moment where dear friend and dear friend who's known Ike for a long time is going to share with us in singing Amazing Grace.
Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now am found, was blind, but now I see. Yea, when this flesh and heart shall fail, and mortal life shall cease, I shall possess within the veil a life of joy and peace. When we've been there 10,000 years, bright shining as the sun, we've no less days to sing God's praise than when we first began.
Thank you, Diana. And she is with us and listening to the service with us this day. Scripture readings came from Ike's own Bible, and these were underlining things that he had in there. And I'm going to share several of them with you. We'll start with the first three. I love this. From Proverbs. I think the book of Proverbs is fascinating. None of you had a chance to sit down and really enjoy it. Grandchildren are the crown of the aged. What a lovely piece. And from Proverbs 20:29. The glory of young men is their strength, and the glory of old men is their gray hair. And from Ecclesiastes, there's a lot of Bible's a lot of fun, the Bible is. Ecclesiastes 5:15. And I commend enjoyment, for the man has no good thing under the sun to eat but and drink and enjoy himself. For this will go with him in his toil through the days of life which God gives him under the sun. And I invite you to join me. The 23rd Psalm is really written, you know, even people that have never been in the church know it, and they think it's just a nice poem. But it's scripture that is written to bring us comfort and to bring us peace as we are the living. So join with me in the 23rd Psalm. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell well in the house of the Lord. A couple more scripture lessons from Corinthians, 1 Corinthians 16, verse 13. Be watchful, stand firm in your faith, be courageous, be strong, let all that you do be done in love. And then from 2 Timothy, the Lord will rescue me from every evil and save me from his heavenly kingdom. To him be glory forever and ever. Amen. A few words, and then we'll have sharing from Hike's grandchildren to begin. So I want to just say that I can tell when I meet people like their spirit. And Hike had this very gentle, kind, good spirit. It was just good. He felt like like just somebody who was very humble and very caring and very giving. And one of the things that I loved about him was his, the Bible talks about giving in secret, not to glorify yourself. And he did that. He gave very, very generously in secret and humility of himself and of his, not just material things, but of who he was in his living. He gave him that person, just an incredible man. And the thing that is our legacy, we mistakenly think that our legacy is in things and what our name is on. Our legacy is in what we leave behind in the memories of people. And boy, what a beautiful legacy he has, that he has left behind for so many. And just giving people this wonderful gift of learning how to really celebrate life. And so in remembering him, we share the stories to celebrate him and to let that be his legacy that we continue. So this is a beginning of the sharing, and we pass these stories on for generations to come. They are beautiful stories that I'm going to be honored to read and share with you after the grandchildren share. So I'm very grateful for this opportunity to get to know him through all of you, and also continue to share these stories. So I'm going to invite Hike's grandchildren to come up, and I think Michael is first. Thank you.
Good I'd like to just take this moment to say thank you to Grandpa Hike. Grandpa Hike, thank you. Thank you for laying the foundation upon which we all stand. Thank you for telling it exactly how you saw it. Thank you for putting others' best interests ahead of your own. Thank you for all you've done for us, for all you've done for me. Thank you for being someone to look up to, someone to aspire to be like. Thank you for the wisdom you've imparted upon us. Thank you for your humor. Thank you for your kindness and grace. And thank you for being you. Rest now, assured you prepared us to carry on in your memory. We miss you, Grandpa.
I'm going to read for Danny. It's very hard to stand up here and share your thoughts. And so I am very honored to do this. 4 months shy of his 99th birthday, Kevin gained a man with many hats beyond his years, a visionary, craftsman, and Mr. Fix-It. A Navy veteran who traveled the world during World War II, a politician, and a comedian. My biggest fan. Grandpa was the most hardworking, meticulous, witty man with a heart of gold and pizzazz for life. It's been a true blessing to have shared so many fond memories and life lessons with him, him once that will be forever instilled with me. And I have experienced his unconditional love, wisdom, and intuition. I'm especially thankful for our drives on back roads through the North Country, Adirondack Park adventures, lunch dates paired with a Busch Light before his afternoon nap, for developing a great number of appreciations for the mighty St. Lawrence River and Thousand Islands region. Grandpa created summer straight out of a children's fairy tale. The river will never be the same, but I hope to continue his tradition with my family for years to come. Thanks to him. Give Grandma a big hug for us until we meet again. Here's to you. Love, you.
So I had a really hard time thinking of what to say, and the other day I found this poem on my grandpa's dresser, and I think he had it a really long time because it's pretty old. I think this is what he thought about the Navy and his time in it. The poem is called Navy Life, and I'll read it for you. I am sitting here thinking of the days I left behind, and I think I'll put on paper what is running through my mind. People on the outside think a sailor's life is swell, but I'll let you in on something, mate, a sailor's life is hell. A sailor's got one consolation though, gather close and I'll tell. When I die, I'll go to heaven because I've served my stretch in hell. I've scrubbed a million bulkheads and I've chipped a lot of paint. A meaner place this side of hell, I swear I know there ain't. I've stood for many hours just to get my mail, and I've stood a million watches, and I've been on every special detail. I've shined a million miles, and I've made a million ports. I've spent my night in dirty grates just trying to be a sport. But when those final taps have sounded, and I lay aside life's care, I'll take my final shore leave right up those golden stairs. To then St. Peter will greet me, and loudly will he yell, Take your front seat in heaven, sailor. You've served your stretch in hell. I'd also like to share two memories that I think show what he meant to me and what a great sense of humor he had. So first, I was 3 or 4 years old and I had to go to daycare. I had to go to Promised Land, and it was the worst. I hated it. And one day around Christmas time, at nap time, I was called into the office. When I got there, both my grandma and my grandpa were there to rescue me, or so I thought. I was so happy and so relieved to be with them and not at Promised Land. I thought that they came all this way just to rescue me. And the other one is one of the times when we were here at church in fellowship hall with my grandpa. We were, you know, surrounded by all the church attendees. The church had just enacted these new protocols, and then the minister had said something, and every church attendee raised their hands and started to wave like this. And my grandpa leaned over to me in a whisper, which if you knew him, there was no such thing as a whisper, that I don't know why the hell they do this. They look ridiculous. I immediately laughed. Thank you for everything, Grandpa. The river will not be the same without you, but I know you are still here with everyone. I'll always know you're with me in every smile, every tear, every political debate, every Christmas, and every river breeze. I love you, Grandpa.
Hello. So today I want to tell you guys what my grandpa meant to me. He was always somebody that I looked up to, and the love that he had for our family truly knew no bounds. In his 80s, he built my family a jet ski ramp using nothing but his bare two hands. And I remember thinking about how lucky I was that even though, you know, my grandpa was getting up there in years, he was still able to do this incredible thing for our family. He'd always tell me stories about how the river looked back in the day, and I'll always cherish the boat rides that we have, that we had together. And that's truly where my love of the river comes from. My grandpa was an incredibly kind, generous, and grounded man. And while I might know, while I might not know what the future of our family holds or looks like without grandpa, I know that I'm a better person because I was loved by him. I only hope that I can live up to the example of love, strength, character, and integrity that he set for all of us. While he's no longer here to say that he's proud of me, I carry his strength in my heart. The kindest compliment that I hope to hear any day is that my grandpa would be proud of me. And now I'd like to leave you with these final words. Our grandpa kept a garden of the heart. He planted all the good things that gave our lives their start. He turned us to the sunshine and encouraged us to dream, fostering and nurturing the seeds of self-esteem. And then the winds and the rain came, and he protected us enough, but not too much, because he knew we would stand up strong and tough. His constant good example always taught us right from wrong, markers for our pathway that will last a lifetime long. We are our grandpa's children. We are his legacy. Thank you, Grandpa. I love you.
Thank you, Marty. I'm going to read the eulogies from each of Hike's daughters, and these are beautiful. And I guys, sit down. Y'all need to sit down because it's going to be about 45 minutes. And you're going to love it. I mean, every bit of it is wonderful, but you're going to get tired if you're standing there. Thank you. I feel better already. So this begins, I'm telling tales, oldest to youngest. So we begin with Susan's. I love reading these. It says, my parents loved each other and they loved us. And we were so fortunate to know that. I hope the three of us let them know how we felt, that we felt the same way about them. My father told me a few years ago that he felt so lucky Most people his age had kids who wanted to put them in a nursing home and forget about them. His words, not mine. But his daughters worked to spend time with him. Each of us wanted him to move closer to us or live with one of us. So maybe he did understand. My father kissed my mother and us before he left for work. This was just a small way we saw his affection for all of us. If my mother went out for a meeting, we didn't look at caring. He didn't look at it as caring for us as babysitting. He knew how to get us ready and for and into bed. He knew how to cook a meal. As a matter of fact, he used those times to prepare things like shrimp that my mother didn't cook. I remember a neighbor and relative who used to call my father Mother Morris. He could have taken lessons from my father. There were other things Dad did that helped him earn this nickname. Until I was in fifth grade, we lived in a second floor apartment, and my mother might have done laundry, but Dad was willing to carry the laundry downstairs and hang it out if we were home. He looked at it just as something he needed to do to help my mother. Dad would say, now that there are many years when he lived paycheck to paycheck, but he was always a good provider. I don't know how he did it, but we had presents under the Christmas tree piled high. There wasn't much on our Christmas list that wasn't opened on Christmas morning. My dad worked in a factory for most of his life, but his three little girls had play clothes, school clothes, church clothes, new dresses, coats, hats, shoes, and purses for Easter every year. Raincoats and boots, sleighs and skis, and bikes, and wagons, and pogo sticks, and stilts, and fishing poles, and the list goes on and on. Most importantly, besides the stuff, Dad gave us his time. He was a hands-on father. He took us fishing and taught us how to ride our bikes, helped us with homework, defended us, and made us think. I hated when he played devil's advocate, but I am grateful for being taught to look at issues from different points of view. On Saturday nights, he danced to Lawrence Welk with us and let us style his hair. I wish I could. He told us stories about the world he traveled when he was in the Navy and read stories from the family Bible. When my mom went to work, I think I was in eighth grade, and we had to sit down with Dad where we discussed how our lives would be different, how our responsibilities would increase, and how important it would be to work as a team. Another sit down for the Morris girls came when Connie was pretty young. Sorry, Connie, she put tails on you. She told a friend that she was gonna do something, but didn't do it. Now that didn't sit well with my father, who told her she should have done what she said she was going to do. And Connie said, it's okay, because she didn't say, I promise. Whoa, he made the three of us sit down on the couch and explain, your word, even if you don't say I promise, your word is your word, even if you don't say I promise. Her response was the same, over and over. He explained it as many different ways and as patiently as possible, but she kept saying she hadn't promised. It took a long time before this lesson on kindness and honesty sank into his satisfaction. I didn't always find my father a patient man. However, I remember when he came to pick me up from college in Plattsburgh for Christmas holidays. He drove four other girls home too, and had to spend time rearranging gifts and luggage in our station wagon until everything would fit. We'd drop off the girls off in North Lawrence, Norwood, Canton, and Ogdensburg. And what did each of my friends say about him? Your father is so patient. My father? I thought, eventually I decided you were right. He was usually very patient. He took great care in answering questions. I remember asking what INC meant at the end of a business name. And instead of just telling me incorporated, I got 10-minute explanation. I was amazed that three little letters with a period could mean all of that. He was always a teacher. He taught us a love of trees, the river, the importance of hard work, wanting to learn, maintaining a healthy curiosity about things. When I was learning to ride a two-wheeler, I was upset because the training wheels were not balanced evenly with the back tire. He said they had to be unbalanced. Training wheels were there to help me if I started to fall. If the tires were all even, I would never learn to ride a two-wheeler. Well, when I fell, old Doc Morse would patch up my skin knees, encourage me to get right back on the bike. Don't be afraid to fall. It's not far down, it's good advice. He gave me advice that got me through every single job interview I ever had. Just remember, he said, the person who was interviewing you once stood in the doorway with sat in his hand too. My father, the armchair philosopher and eternal pessimist. He was a warrior. He could talk himself into a worry. One time we were going to an event for my sisters, and he and I were ready, and my mother and sisters were not. As he paced around the house, I asked why he was so nervous, and he said he was worried he'd be late. I said I didn't think we would be, but it was my sister's event, and if she wasn't worried about being late, he shouldn't. He replied that he learned a long time ago that if he wasn't worrying, the person who should be worrying probably wasn't either. So he had to worry for them. He worried for and about everyone. Often my father was worrying about the little guy. He had a soft spot for the underdog, any underdog. My mother taught her grandchildren to call the St. Lawrence River the beautiful St. Lawrence River. If my mother thought the river beautiful, my father might have thought the river mighty. He had a healthy respect for all waterways, though. The Oswegatchie, Black Lake, or Mud Lake were all beautiful to him. He was heard more than one occasion to say the St. Lawrence was so big that it took attention away from the other beautiful waterways in the area that never got their due respect. When I lived in Ogdensburg, I became a church deacon. Deacons in our church try to help folks who have some kind of need. He never made a comment when I was on session for Council of Christian Education, but he did when I was a deacon. That's what church should be about, reaching out and helping others. I agree with you. Deacons are my favorite officers in the church. They do amazing. It's amazing work. I sometimes think of my dad as everyone's father. An adult friend of mine recently asked if I thought my father was a doctor. Another adult friend recently said, we are so lucky to have a father who listened and talked to us. Our house seemed to be a magnet for many of my sister's friends. At Christmas time, they came for my mother's fudge and my father's presents. One of the regulars sent my father a letter in 2006, and it said, dear Mr. Morse, thank you so much for always welcoming and letting me feel a part of your family. I count you among a handful of men who have been very positive influence in my life. I will forever be grateful to you. I remember another gal who spent a lot of time and ate a lot of meals, including Thanksgiving and Christmas at our house. She and my sisters were playing hide and go seek in our attic. She was hiding where she wasn't supposed to be and put her foot through the ceiling in my bedroom. Then when my mother sent me upstairs to investigate why it was so quiet, there was Sandra trying to fix the ceiling with black electrical tape, wondering if my father would notice. Dodie stood there wringing her hands looking like she was about to cry, repeating over and over again, your father's gonna kill me, your father's gonna kill me. My father didn't kill anyone, but I wouldn't have been surprised if he gave Sandy County and Dodie a refresher course on where they were and were not supposed to play hide and go seek. Dad was a dreamer. He used to say, if you don't have your hopes and dreams, you might as well jump off the bridge. I remember my mother once sending me up to camp to check on him. He was working by himself on camp and had gone much longer than she anticipated. When I got up to camp, he had just finished working on for the day and was about to sit and have a beer. As we were talking, he brought up the subject of the dreams that he and my mother had. One dream that had completely come true for them was that the three of us had all gotten our educations and seemed to have jobs with benefits that we liked. They were happy for our success. Our father was also a practical realist. When early in my career, I was ready to leave for my first job, I was reluctant to tell my parents. I did not want to sign my contract for another year, but I did not have a new job lined up. My parents surprised me. They told me I had been in Tupper Lake for 5 years. I had given it a good shot. I knew if I wanted to leave or stay. I was not married. I had no responsibilities to anyone except myself. It was a perfect time to move on. I moved home with their blessing and on Labor Day moved on to a new job. Thank you, Mom and Dad. What a great gift. My mother once told our neighbors that older ladies needed someone to paint their front, paint their front porch. She told them that I would do it. I was incredulous when she told me she'd offer my services. I don't know anything about painting. I said, why would you tell them I would do it? She replied, oh, because you can do anything. And she meant it. Shocking, but another great gift. As an adult, my father was quite a reader and watcher of the news. Even at 98, he was well-informed and retained so much. I would not have known he was dyslexic and had any difficulty in school. He was very modest about his accomplishments and didn't think himself very bright. He was always compared himself to his older siblings, Jack and Marion, who were so much more academic. He was one of the brightest, most capable men I've ever known. When he worked at Alcoa Aluminum, he turned down an opportunity to take classes at Clarkson University and earn an engineering degree at the company's expense. I asked him if he ever regretted that decision. He said no. He would have been working and taking classes at the same time. He had a wife and 3 kids and didn't know if he would ever see them if he were on that schedule. Then when Alcoa had layoffs, those men in the program were the first ones laid off. He didn't know if any of them were ever able to finish their degree. He felt he'd made the right decision. He used to tell us that he did not have any regrets for the decisions we made as long as we thought it through first, looked at it from both sides, did our research, and thought about the consequences. He is our family's hero, but I don't want to make him sound like he was a saint. He could be a bit of a rebel, sometimes irreverent, exhibit quite a biting sense of humor, and call things the way he saw them. When he was a boy, he used to follow his older brother Jack around. To quote Dad, we were terrible, in trouble all the time. One funny little story was probably just about being a 7-year-old boy. Grandma got him all dressed up to take him somewhere and told him to stay clean for a few minutes while she finished getting ready. He decided to ride his bike while he waited for him. A couple blocks away, they were oiling the road. That smooth slick of oil they had sprayed on the street was very tempting. So of course, he rode his bike across it to watch the trail he was moving. And when he turned, his bike slipped and he went down and was covered with oil. Grandma was not happy, but 90 years later, Dad still laughed about it. It's a great story. Harold Morris is our father, grandfather, great-grandfather, and father-in-law. We wanted his approval. We wanted him to think we were kind, bright, and resourceful. We were never afraid of my father, but afraid of disappointing him. He never disappointed. He fancied walking sticks, L.L. Bean outerwear, Bush beer, and the feel of a grandchild's hand in his. We will miss our hero, but he left us a lifetime of memories, quite a legacy. Thanks, Dad. That's great. Thank you. And the next one is from Sandra. My father was the perfect blend of strength, humor, and wisdom, knowing when to step back and when to step in. He was a mastermind problem solver. His wheels were always turning and trying to figure out one thing or another. Dad was an excellent provider. What we couldn't afford, he would build. He spent a winter in my grandmother's garage building the family boat, which we used for years. As a present, As for presents under the Christmas tree, he would spend October, November, and December working double shifts to be able to buy everything that was on our Christmas list and to pay for everything in cash. Each August, he would go shopping for school clothes. Dad had a list of clothing that he thought we needed, and that is what he bought. We each had to have a pair of school shoes that we would wear each day, sneakers, a pair of dress shoes for church and holidays, a daily jacket for school and for play, and a dress coat, and so on. Even though he didn't make a lot of money, he always took us on vacation, day trips. Mom would pack a picnic basket and off we'd go to adventure lands, the North Pole, and so on. My dad was approachable, easy to talk with, and a great listener. There were a few times that I had to confide in him and get his advice on what he thought, and he always listened with an open mind, telling me what he thought and gave me a few things to think about and never made me retell him anything. I always walked away feeling so much better. My father was an excellent head of the household. He was structured and orderly, and we knew what he expected of each of us. There was a chart in the kitchen telling us our jobs after each meal, and I still remember what I had to do each day of the week. On the weekends, one of us had to dust, one vacuum, and one had to clean the bathroom. We had to do that on Saturday and on Sunday. There was always a calendar in the kitchen with appointments written on it. We were measured twice a year on the woodwork in the kitchen. The height and date were recorded. At 6 o'clock each night, the family watched the news with Walter Crockett Superbad. If the batteries in the flashlight died, we didn't have any at home, he would write on a piece of paper the size of battery needed and put it in the flashlight and add batteries to the ongoing list of things he had to get or do. My dad never crossed the street unless he had a map to get back. Everything was always planned out. My father was ahead of his times. He was a partner to my mother. On his days off, he hung up the wash, helped with household chores, and on holidays, he helped me with the cooking. He helped out with the cooking. He had a love and appreciation for music, both instrumental and vocal, and he liked photography and other art forms. Growing up with my parents, we always knew we were loved without them ever saying that they loved us. We just knew it and felt it. We were the center of their life. Everything revolved around us, our needs, our development, our education, our tradition, our traditions, our family. Their support, help, care, and loyalty to our family were forever present. We knew we were loved unconditionally. Some of my favorite memories. Dad jitterbugging with Susie to the record player. Dad singing Who Threw the Overalls and Mrs. Murphy's Chowder. Dad telling Connie that he bought her from the gumball machine outside of Woolworths. Dad sending me to Woods with a quarter to get a loaf of bread for my first time. Dad laughing right out loud at Jethro Bodine on the Beverly Hillbillies and at Schultz from Hogan's Heroes. Dad catching Mom under the mistletoe and wrapping his arms around her to give her a kiss, and Mom saying, "Oh, Harold." The memories are endless and wonderful. There is a special place in my heart for my father, a place where childhood and lifelong memories will linger, and where thoughts of love and gratitude will remain forever strong. Harold Morris was the best father and man I have ever known. Love your daughter, Sandra. And then from Connie. And he says, I had the privilege and honor of being my dad's caregiver in his very senior years, or as he called me, his secretary. I saw him most every day and listened while he told stories of the way before my time. This essay is my attempt to share some of those stories with you and help you see what a remarkable life he lived. My father was a self-deprecating person. He never thought he did much to contribute to the world or that he lived a very exciting life. Jack called him our Forrest Gump because of his modest ways. He really did experience some incredible events. Early life. Dad was born May 30th, 1922, the third and youngest child of Sarah and Arthur Morris. He He said he had a wonderful childhood. He was 7 when the Great Depression hit the world, and he told me there might have been a depression, but he never really felt it. His parents did a great job making sure their children had a good childhood. During the Depression, my grandfather decided that they would raise and sell rabbits. Daddy said he wasn't sure how many rabbits they sold, but they sure ate a lot of rabbit in this household. Roasted rabbit, rabbit stew, et cetera, et cetera. One day, a person came around with a truck full of strawberries, and my grandfather traded all the rabbits for the truck full of strawberries. My dad said the strawberries were delicious, a delicious break from the rabbit. My father told me a story of Christmas when my grandparents didn't put up decorations beforehand like they had every other year. He and his brother and sisters thought they might not be going to celebrate Christmas that year, but when they woke up Christmas morning, the house was all decorated with gifts under the tree. I thought it was really cool. The Morris household was the first house in the neighborhood to have a telephone. The whole neighborhood would receive all their calls on their phone. Being the youngest, my dad became the neighborhood runner. He said he hated the McFadden family because they had 2 teenage girls and they'd get more phone calls than anyone else. He was constantly running to their house because one of those girls had a phone call. Around the age of 12, Dad and Bud Farley decided that they would build a fort in the Sugarwood across the road from Terrace Park. They cut down branches and made a nice fort. They enjoyed their fort until the farmer found it and called my grandfather. My grandfather and my dad went to see the farmer, who was angry, and told my grandfather that he owed him restitution for the branches cut. My grandfather looked the farmer square in the eye and told him if he didn't back off, he'd pound a copper nail in every tree and ruin his farm. On the way home, my grandfather asked my dad if he really did. Dad said he couldn't remember what he told his father. All he could remember was his father stood up for him with no questions asked. Back in Dad's childhood, they could plow the streets. They always left an inch or two of snow on the road, made for excellent sledding. One of his friends made a toboggan and put 2 long boards between 2 sleds. Dad said about 15 kids could fit on it. And they said the thing zipped down from Montgomery Street Hill, from Franklin Street, clear to Patterson Street. I asked him about traffic and he said there wasn't much back then. They were kids who were worried about traffic if you were a kid. When Dad was a teenager, he and his buddy, Bud Farley, hitchhiked to Auburn, New York. I guess back in those days, hitchhiking was a very acceptable mode of transportation because my grandmother knew that's how he was getting to Auburn. They were going to see Bud's uncle, Uncle Arthur. The only trouble was Bud didn't know where Uncle Arthur lived or what his name was, but he did know that Uncle Arthur worked at the prison. So once they got to Auburn, they immediately went to the prison and started walking around yelling, "Uncle Arthur, Uncle Arthur." And finally, one of the guards in the tower lowered a bucket with his uncle's address and keys to his house. Prior to the U.S. entering World War II, the entire First Army of the United States was doing military maneuvers in St. Lawrence County. There were about 100,000 troops, all from all the states at the east, on the eastern seaboard, from Maine to Virginia. And as a teenager, my dad got a job delivering newspapers to the troops from Philadelphia. He would wait on the street corner at 5 a.m. every morning, be picked up by a truck, jump in the back of the other kids, ride out to the Morley area, take his papers and deliver them to the Pennsylvania encampment. One day after they were done delivering the papers, the driver told them that the president was coming. The driver drove them to a farmhouse with a long driveway. He parked and they waited. Shortly thereafter, Daddy said he saw FDR's touring car pull up. FDR was sitting up on the back of the car. He gave a speech and left. I asked my father if all the troops there were there, and there was a big crowd. He said, no, the troops were doing maneuvers. There were only about 20 people. Once the U.S. was in World War II, my dad decided he wanted to join the Navy. He wanted his friend Mort Backus to sign up with him. Mort told him that Hike would have to convince Mort's father, this is a wonderful story, would have to convince Mort's father that it would be a good idea for Mort to join up. So every Sunday for a couple of months, my dad would go to the Backus farm and talk to Mr. Backus about the virtues of the Navy. One Saturday when he got to the Backus house, he asked Mort where his dad was, and Mort told him his father had joined the Navy. My father had some amazing experiences in the Navy. On November 2nd, 1947, in Long Beach, California, Hartford, he witnessed Howard Hughes' spruce goose fly. That's so cool. It was only ever flown once. With Hughes at the controls, it flew just over a mile at an altitude of 70 feet for 1 minute. He was also present July 1st, 1946, Operation Crossroads, when the first nuclear weapons were detonated on Bikini Tower, and he had tried to blow up German warships that they had captured. He witnessed it with no protective gear on and nobody warning them. He was also present in Normandy on June 6, 1944, D-Day. He was in one of the destroyers farther out, the Allies stormed the beach. He said at night, the sky lit up like fireworks. He also said that it was really the only time during his enlistment that he was scared. Their ship got hit. They crawled their way to London and got repaired. 74 years later, when he was being interviewed for his honored flight, he never mentioned that he was part of the largest seaborne invasion in history. We all should possess such modesty. One of my favorite Navy stories was with the ships pulled into the San Francisco Harbor. They had a week off, and one of his buddies and my dad had hitchhiked back east to visit their families. He said they started out, and a bus passed them, and they got up to the next town and up on the road, and the same bus passed them again. This went on for 4 miles. Oh, 4 miles. It went on 4 miles. Not 4 miles, but 4 miles. That same bus kept passing them every time they stopped, and after a while, the bus would blow its horn and all the passengers would wave and holler at them as it passed. When my father got out of the Navy, he went to Long Island to work. Apparently there was a fellow from Ogdensburg who worked at State Hospital in Long Island, and he recruited workers from his hometown. That's where my mom and dad at Pilgrim State met. She told her girlfriends that dad was a real dreamboat. My mom was also from Ogdensburg, and she would visit home whenever they had time off. One time on the way home, they picked up a hitchhiker, and my mom and dad decided to get married, so they stopped at the Justice of the Peace, and the hitchhiker was a witness. That's a great story too. One of my favorite stories happened after they moved back to Ogdensburg. That's how they got their first vacuum cleaner. Evidently, they were sitting on the front porch when a vacuum cleaner salesman arrived. He gave them a spiel on the virtues of the cleaner. Dad said this guy must have been there for a couple hours. When he finished, he asked my father if he'd like to buy a vacuum. And he told him that he would, the salesman told him he'd need to put $5 down. So to secure the purchase, my father said yes, he would love to, but he had no money. So the salesperson hemmed and hawed, and then he said, if I let you borrow $5, would you buy it? My dad said yes, and the salesman let him borrow $5, and they had themselves a new vacuum. Christmas was always a great celebration at our house. He said he always bought more than he could have, than he should have, because he never knew which toy would be the one to hit home with three kids. That's a lot of toys. On Christmas morning, you could barely walk in our living room because of all the presents. A story my dad liked to tell was one Christmas after the gifts were unwrapped, he asked Susan if she'd had a good Christmas. She told him she did, but she wouldn't have if it wasn't for that guy, Santa. So Daddy said after that, Santa didn't bring all the gifts. He only gave a few, and the rest were for mom and dad. In our talks in later years, he told me he would have taken out, that he often would take out loans for Christmas and get them paid back just in time to take out another one for the current Christmas. But he loved Christmas, and seeing the joy on their faces, knowing how much this holiday meant to my dad, I've spent every Christmas of my life with him until now. It's gonna be hard. When we first started spending summers at camp, I think he wanted us to love it as much as he did growing up. One day after he left for a while and came back with a whole car full of outside games to play, he kept us happy and occupied. That was a real treat. Whenever my dad would go to the river, he would do a shallow dive off the rock ledge in front of our camp, and he'd come up from his dive and yell at the top of his lungs because the water was cold. I'm sure you all experienced that. Everyone on the point knew that Hike had just jumped in the river. I remember that for many years. He wore Hawaiian board shorts for his swim trunks. It's funny how some things stick with you. The first few years we were at camp, we had an outhouse. My dad told me that I used to feel sorry for the neighbors because they didn't have one. He worked for years remodeling the camp to bring it into modern times. Thus, the new windows and indoor plumbing, a bathroom, a new kitchen, paneling on the walls, the bigger front porch, the orange carpeting. It's a complete renovation, which has changed little to this day. One summer when I was 13, Sandra was 15, we planned to get away to an island with a few girls. We had worked out with the neighbor kid who had his own boat to take us to the island and pick us up the next day. We didn't tell our parents. Sandra and I told Mom that we were going to spend the night with friends. And the other girls told their parents that they were staying at our camp. To make a long story short, our folks all talked to each other and figured out where we were. And we were in big trouble. Sandra and I went to bed very early that night to avoid the wrath of our mother. Dad got home from work around 11 p.m. We heard our mom telling him about our escape, and he started laughing and called us Frank and Jesse James. Dad always used to say that camp was for company. Upstairs had several beds. Every couch turned into a bed. Plus, there were air mattresses on the floor. It was not unusual for us to have a camp full. The dining room table had a lot of leaves, and it was normal for us to use them all at dinner. We'd have to run all over the camp to get all the available chairs to put around it. Dad sat at the head of the table, and I always was amazed at how many corns on the cob he could eat. When he wasn't sitting at the head of the table, you could probably find him in his rocking chair drinking a beer, admiring the river. He loved the river. He was always the loudest laugh in the house. In the summer, my mom and he used to get up very early and sit out on the porch camp and have their coffee. I could hear them talking in low voices. They were good friends and talked a lot. When I would get up and walk out on the porch, he would say in a very booming voice, "It's a beautiful day in the North Country." Daddy was a big family. Nothing was more important to him. He and my mom always made sure we had everything we needed and then some. They often went without so us kids could have everything we wanted. One Christmas when Jack and I lived across the street from the golf course, Daddy, Dan, and Jack all took his grandkids, Michael, Matthew, Daniel, Marty, and Audrey. Did you go by Audrey Catherine? That's what mom wrote. sledding on a course. On the course. The kids laughed and squealed, just having a grand time. Dad looked at Jack and Dan and said, "Doesn't get any better than this." He was a big singer. He loved to sing and listen to music. He was a dancer too. He said back in his day, that's what kids did for entertainment. There were dance halls all over the North Country then. One New Year's Eve, when my mom went to a party at the Odd Fellows Hall, Dad had my mom up dancing and twirled around so enthusiastically that she ended up in the band's bass drum. After we left the house, my mom bought a small dog and they named it Abby. The dog, my dad became best friends. They hung out all the time, doing pretty much everything together. He was crazy about that little dog. Bought him clothes, a raincoat, rain boots, as well as a life jacket for the boat. My father loved to walk. He would walk 2 to 3 miles a day. He walked right up until his mid-90s when he began to hurt too much to walk. He also loved to go for rides in the country. When we were kids and money was hard to come by, on Sunday afternoons, he'd pick up my grandma and we'd go for long rides. My mom would pack picnic lunches. I love to go for rides to this day. My dad's twilight years, he saw most of his contemporaries pass on. He would sometimes tell them that he didn't understand why he got left behind. At these times, I usually would bring him up to my camp and we'd sit on the porch and admire the river. The river always made him happy. I could go on and on, but I think you'll get the idea. He was quite a person. The minister, talking about me, the minister at his church called him a gentle soul. He was, really was. I guess I never thought of him that way, but it's a nice description. Speaking of the First Presbyterian Church, my dad was a member here his entire life. It's the church he was raised in. It's the church he raised us kids in. It's the church my sister Susan and I were married in, and the church my daughter Audrey, Catherine, will renew her vows. I'm really gonna miss my dad. I'll miss how he worries about me and my children. I'll miss his words of wisdom. I'll miss driving around the burg with him and having him tell me how it used to be. I'll miss hearing stories about his life. I'll miss our arguments over politics. Y'all argue over politics. I'll miss having him sit on my porch and tell me river stories. I'll miss Christmas with him. I'm really gonna miss my dad. I hope he's sitting on the front porch at camp in heaven, talking with my mom and admiring me. And I'm sure he is. Thank you so much for sharing the stories. I'm sure dad is in a great place. He's walking again and feeling good about it, doing the things he wants to do and making people laugh. And just enjoying and celebrating Moses. A good, good, good soul. A gentle soul in my mind. Very quiet and humble and incredible humility. And he is definitely with God, one of God's servants to this world. He changed the world in his being. And that's all we got. That's our job, right? We come here and make the world a better place by how we live. And he did that. He made the world a better place in his living. And he is at peace. We give thanks to God for that. Let's turn our hearts and minds to God in prayer. Eternal God, we thank you today for the beauty of your creation. And we thank you. We thank you for the life of Harold Hyde Morris. His love and wisdom have meant so much to us. You gave him to us. Such a gift is hard to give back to you now. Son, husband, father, and devoted grandfather, role model to more than we may know on this day. And today we say our goodbyes, knowing, oh God, that you have embraced and gathered him close to you in ways that we sometimes fail to understand. We thank you. We thank you, loving God, for giving us Harold to so many years to this week. Our journey here on earth was made better by his presence. Gracious God, help us to believe where we've not seen and trust you to lead us through our years and bring us at last into your home, eternal life with our risen Son. In the name of our risen Lord, we pray together using the prayer that he taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. We're going to have Connie and Sally are going to sing for us and quietly come along. How great thou art. Are you going to do all the, how many verses are you going to do? Two verses, one and five, one, yeah, one first and last. Okay, two verses of How Great Thou Art.
I see. how you have given us new life in Christ. We commend our doors to your merciful care and our faith in Christ our Lord, who died and rose again to save us and now lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. I want to close with a little piece paraphrasing what friends Ben and Connie wrote, but I bet you thought I forgot. Ben and Connie wrote this wonderful little note that sums up wonderful things. It says, chatting with him is always a highlight on trips to the river. Thanks for his good humor and, of course, his supernatural good memory. We'll think fondly of sharing beers with him on the patio and hearing about adventures in the Pacific, not to mention his encyclopedic knowledge of the St. Lawrence. I valued his independence, and he was happy he kept it, much of it, into very old age. So admirable. May his memory be a blessing. So may each of us take those thoughts with us as we live our lives being a blessing. I invite you to please, if you're able to comfortably do so, please stand. May we each live our lives sharing and being a joy to others. After the lesson, we're going to close with our song that we will all remember and celebrate together as we think of Hike, Dad, Grandpa. The song that he taught his children to sing and probably sang with a bit of a twinkle in his eye. So after the lesson, I invite you to let your hearts be filled with joy and love and celebration and live your life after his example. Now may the love of God, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the communion of the Holy Spirit be with us all now and always. Amen.